All right, folks, welcome to another 2 hours of Hot Potato Radio here in brand new studios. For us, Engineer Bill, this is old stomping ground for him. For me, this is like Christmas in the candy store. Boy, I get everything I want right here. Brand new studios down here at KOTK. Tonight, we're talking about The Passion. I saw it last Tuesday night. Want to hear what you have to think about this movie that has been probably more talked about and more polarizing than any movie I've ever seen in my entire life. I'd like to know what you have to think about it tonight as we talk for the next 2 hours about the Mel Gibson's Passion. Stay right there.
Let's talk.
All right, folks, welcome to another 2 hours of Hot Potato Radio here on Hot Talk 1080 KOTK. My name is Bob Cryder with you for the next 2 hours as we kind of muck our way through the fourth dimension of life trying to figure out what's going on down there. Just to get a little comfortable in here. Engineer Bill, this is your old stomping ground,
isn't it? This is home for me, yes.
This is it. So over the other place was slumming for you.
I wouldn't say slumming, but just not used to it.
It's not used to it. It's not used to it. So here we are down here. I mean, is this how the big boys play now?
This
here?
Is now you're dealing with a radio conglomerate.
This is
now
it.
This is it. But anyway,
so any minute Donald Trump can walk in the door. Is that right?
I don't know about Donald Trump, but Jack Hutchinson, our manager, could, and he's a pretty important person.
Is he pretty important?
Yeah, pretty important.
Okay, and so we'll leave Steinbrenner and Trump and all of those guys somewhere else.
East Coast.
Okay.
I did want to say though, your show is kind of like the guinea pig for our phone lines. All weekend they haven't really been working very well. So 503-250-1080, 1-800-727-5955. We're hoping that your show is the first one to actually get the phone lines to work, and we can get more than one on at a time. So
if a guy calls up and says, "Hello, New Zealand,"
keep
we got
crossed.
Problems, right?
I don't think we'll get New Zealand.
Okay.
If we can get more than one person to call at a time, I will be the happiest person right now. Clyde coming on after you will be extremely happy.
That's right. Yeah.
We will all be happy. And we can thank you. You have brought the change.
Oh, man. Tell me more. Just put another zero on my paycheck, will you?
It's all zeros.
Okay, Engineer Bill.
Yeah,
zeros. It's really weird to look at you like this.
We're different now. Yeah,
it's a
different feel.
We're farther away from each other.
But closer in some respects.
Isn't it true? Aren't you something? All right, folks. The next 2 hours here on Hot Potato Radio, we're going to talk about Mel Gibson's film, The Passion. Now, let me just tell you right off the bat that for some of you, you have been passioned out. You have no more passion about The Passion because you've heard about it, talked everywhere. You've talked about it. You've discussed it. You've seen it. The reason I want to talk about it tonight is because this is the first week we actually have seen the film. All right. I got a chance to get in and see it on Tuesday night, the night before it officially opened. And so I'd like to know what you have to think about it. But let me give you the phone numbers and tell you a little bit about what Hot Potato Radio is all about. And then we'll just keep moving ahead with the program. Phone numbers here in the Portland area, 503-250-1080. 503-250-1080. If you're calling from outside the Portland area, we will pay the bill. You make the call. 1-800-727-5955. 1-800-727-5955. Folks, let me just tell you what Hot Potato Radio is all about, and then you'll know how to get in on here. And let me just tell you right up front, if you call in the first hour, I'll give you as much time as you want to talk, all right? As much time as I can spare, I'll give it to you the first hour. If then the lines light up the second hour, then we got trouble. Because then I have to take, I'll talk with you as much as I can, but then I've got 12 people waiting, I got to jump onto the other line. But if you want to call right up front, this ought to be fairly easy. If you've seen the movie, if you haven't seen the movie, if you've heard it discussed, if you've thought about it, what is this movie all about? What are they trying to say? What have they left unsaid? What shouldn't they have said? What shouldn't they have shown? Have they shown not enough, too much? It goes on and on and on. Folks, on Hot Potato Radio, what we do is we look at life from the fourth dimension. First dimension, the physical dimension. We all need physical exercise. We need food. We need rest. We have physical problems. And when we do it, we go to see the doctor. The doctor tells us what to do, and hopefully that will cure our physical problems. We all live in the physical dimension. Secondly, we live in the mental dimension. There are a certain amount of mental information that you and I must have if we're going to make it through this life. Folks, you're not going to run a cash register if you can't tell that 25 cents and 50 cents are 75 cents. You're not going to make it there. There's certain mental information. There are people working in medicine. There are people working in nuclear physics. All of that. All of that information came through the mental gate, so to speak. And so we all live in the physical dimension, excuse me, the mental dimension, and we need certain mental knowledge. That's why we go to school. You go to, you know, elementary school, middle school, and high school. You may go into college, you may go into grad school. You may do all of that. All of that is to get the mental information because we live in the mental dimension. The third dimension we live in is the emotional dimension. We all have a desire to love and a desire to be loved. And the emotional dimension is very, very important, especially in the world we're living in, this haywire world we're living in. And when our emotions get out of whack, that's when you go to see a psychologist, psychiatrist, whatever. Hopefully they can help put you back together. They put you on Prozac or some kind of antidepressant or anti-anxiety or something to try to get you back on an even keel, because the emotional dimension can screw up every other part of your life. But folks, every one of us ask at one time or the other the big questions in life. The big questions in life are questions like, who am I? Where did I come from? Why am I here? And where am I going? And folks, you can only answer those questions in the fourth dimension, and that's the spiritual dimension. Only down there can you find those answers to those questions, and that's what this show is all about. We talk about life from the fourth dimension, the spiritual dimension of life, and that's why tonight, for the next 2 hours, you have your opportunity to get on board and say what you want to say. Tonight, the theme is on Mel Gibson's film, The Passion. You've heard about it and talked about for weeks as it's run up to the film. Now the film is actually being shown in theaters. I had the opportunity to see it last Tuesday night before it opened officially on Wednesday. You may have seen it, and I have a number of questions for you. I have a number of issues for you. I don't think I have ever in my lifetime, I have never known a man such as Mel Gibson who has been willing to take such a chance on a film. Not only did he take a chance, man, has he taken the shots for it. I'm amazed at what Mel Gibson has gone through to put this stuff down on film. And yet, I keep looking around and I'm saying, and where's the new stuff about this? I mean, if you know anything about the religious writings of the world, the Bhagavad Gita, the Quran, the Hadith, things of this nature, if you've read the New Testament, the stuff that you see on that film is basically been written in the New Testament of the Bible for the last 2,000 years. I keep saying to myself, so where's all the new stuff that's supposed to get everybody all cranked up? In fact, not only is there stuff on the film that you could have read for the last 2,000 years, there's stuff that's been written for the last 2,000 years in the New Testament that is not on the film. That would make it even more of a hot potato to touch, all right? So if you want on board, 503-250-1080, 503-250-1080, 1-800-727-5955. Five. All right, I think there are three bogus things about that's been said about this film. Three bogus things, all right? One is that it was anti-Semitic. It's not anti-Semitic. You need to understand that. You need to understand that this happened in the context of history. It happened in some land at some time involving some people. It happened in the land of Israel. It happened with the Jewish people. There was an itinerant preacher by the name of Jesus that came on the scene. And folks, we like to, I mean, the talk shows have portrayed it about this young preacher who got up against the authorities, the religious authorities, and they nailed him to the cross for it. That's only part of it. The problem is the Jews believe that they know the one true living God. His name is Yahweh. They would never say Yahweh, but they believe there's the one true living God. All right? This man by the name of Jesus comes along and says, guess what? I'm the son of that God, which makes me equal to that God, which makes me God. That's why they nailed him to the cross. Not because he came along and said, I don't like the way you have the temple painted, and I don't like the way you do this, and you don't do that. He came along, and he said, I am God. Surprise. I am God. So the first thing about it is it's anti-Semitic. It's not anti-Semitic. It's just like, if you see the movie and you watch the brutality of the Romans, how come the people in Italy aren't up in arms and saying it's anti-Italian? How come, you want to talk about the brutality? It's the Romans who are brutal And they're Italian. So where's the anti, you know, Italian aspect of this film? So the first bogus thing about it is it's anti-Semitic. It happened in the context of history, and history will prove that it will show that it happened among the Jews. All right? The second thing is it's going to break down dialogue between interfaith people. That is, we've just began to learn to talk to each other, and then this comes along, and it breaks out. Well, folks, let me just tell you something. If you have to begin talking with others by ignoring history, I've already got a problem with you. If you think that the only way to begin talking with a person who is a Muslim is to ignore the historical facts about Muhammad, I got a problem. If you think the only way to start talking among each other is kind of be revisionist about history, and therefore, if we don't tell the truth, we can really talk. Folks, let me ask you a question. How are you going to talk if you can't tell the truth? If you can't sit down, look each other in the eye and say, this is the truth. What are we going to do about it? So the second bogus thing about it is it's going to break down this inter-ecumenical talk between people, all right? It just is true. It's historically true. We have to know that. Is that, for example, the first thing in order for whites and blacks in America to talk is to rewrite the whole idea about slavery? Is that the only way we can talk? Or is the way we really talk is to acknowledge the flagrant, blatant, ugly truth about slavery, and then we can talk? When it comes down to the passion, people are saying, well, the discourse will stop going on. And so therefore, we have to whitewash history. I got news for you. It doesn't happen that way. All right? 503-250-1080, 1-800-727-5955. If you've seen The Passion and you like it, I want to know. If you've seen The Passion and you don't like it, I want to know. If you haven't seen the film and you don't plan to see it, I would like to know why you don't plan to see it. If you haven't seen it, you plan to see it, tell me why you're going to go, all right? 503-250-1080, 1-800-727-5955. Be right back. All right, folks, welcome back to Hot Potato Radio here on Hot Talk 1080 KOTK. Let me just tell you, in the move over to these brand new studios, our bumper music got bumped somewhere else. And so while we're trying to reestablish it, we're just kind of going in and out with the nice music. All right, welcome back to Hot Potato Radio here on Hot Talk 1080 KOTK. Bob Cryder, if you want to get on board here in the local area, 503-250-1080. If you're calling from outside the 503 area code, it's 1-800-727-5955. 1-800-727-5955. We're trying to get links up. We're trying to get computers running. We're trying to make sure the radio is working right. And so you're going to have to give us a break here as we're making this switch. It always happens. That's what technology is all about. Tonight we're talking about Mel Gibson's The Passion. And if you've seen it and you like it, I want to know why. If you've seen it and you don't like it, I want to know why. If you haven't seen it and you plan to see it, I want to know why. If you haven't seen it and you plan to see it, I want to know why. And if you haven't seen it and you don't plan to see it, I want to know why. Because I think this movie is probably going to get more people talking about the basis of what Jesus Christ is all about than anything since the writing of the Bible. We're going to try something. Here we go, Engineer Bill. Let's see if the phones actually work. Andy, are you there?
Yeah, I'm here.
Hey, Bill, it works. Andy, welcome to Hot Potato Radio.
I've actually been looking forward to the show all week.
Good, good.
And you actually left something out of your list.
Okay, hit it.
Those who have seen it and don't know if they like it or dislike it.
Oh, okay. You've seen it?
I've seen it.
And you're not sure?
I am not sure.
Why, Andy? Tell me.
You know, there was a lot of gore. Mm-hmm. I mean, it was hard to watch. And maybe that's the reason why I don't like it. As far as what I could imagine as a very accurate portrayal of history, you know, excluding whether or not Jesus was truly the Son of God or not, this mm-hmm. movie was fantastic. You know, there were some minor flaws, like heights of buildings and garbage like that.
Yeah, but, because they had to film it other than Jerusalem, yeah. That type of thing, yeah.
Yeah, and that part I truly loved. You know, to this moment, I cannot tell you whether or not I like or dislike the movie.
Okay, let me ask you this, Andy. In terms of, if you, let's separate it two different ways, all right? Because one thing is a lot of people go to movies. Movies today are pure entertainment, okay? Yeah. So on the entertainment side, you weren't entertained, right? Do I get that?
I guess you could say that.
Because this film wasn't meant as entertainment. I mean, we know that. Okay. On the history side, what did you think? In the telling of the history of the story as we have it, what did you think?
I thought it was great. And it's kind of hard to... I've not heard anyone say, you know, what happened here, la-di-da-da-da, is totally unfactual.
Yeah, they can't do that because it's totally factual according to the history that we have.
Yeah. And so that's why when I hear some of these criticisms, it's anti-Semitic, it's this, it's that, it's history. And for all we can tell, that's as close as we can get. Sure, Pontius Pilate, you know, he looked a little, indecisive.
See, but I don't see, Andy, that I don't agree with. I mean, there are some big top guys. Bill O'Reilly, for one of them on his show, said, you know, Pilate was a thug and he was a this and he was that. That's true about everything else in Pilate. When you look at the life of Pilate, you see it as true. But what we have in history, when Pilate confronts Jesus of Nazareth, there is this incredible indecisiveness that because all of a sudden, I think Pilate thinks he might be coming up against somebody who's totally different than he's ever been up against in the past. Yeah. I don't think you ought to feel sorry for the man, I don't think Gibson portrays him that way. But the history books tell us a couple of things. Number one, he did try to release Jesus of Nazareth. He said, I find no fault in this man. I find no reason to crucify him. History tells us that's true. Second of all, in order to try to get Jesus off his back, and hearing that he came from Galilee, he sent him over to King Herod, who was nothing more than a buffoon. The books showed him right there. The film showed him right there. He was a buffoon. He tried to get him off his back by sending him over to Herod. Herod couldn't get a word out of him, so he put a purple robe on him and mocked him, sent him back to Pilate, and then Pilate did something that is unheard of in Roman history, as far as I know. He takes a basin of water, and he washes his hands in front of the entire crowd, and he said, I am innocent of the blood of this man. See to it yourself. He tries to get Barabbas to be crucified in the place of Christ. All of that is history. And so if Pilate turns out to be a thug over there, or a mobster over there, I understand that. But the way history has it, when he confronts this person by the name of Jesus of Nazareth, this guy is caught between a rock and a hard place. He doesn't want to crucify him. And yet, the bottom line, is when the high priest, and history tells us, this is what he yelled. He said, if you let him go, you are no friend of Caesar's. And that put Pilate over the edge. Because Pilate already, and it's true, right after this happened, Pilate was called back to Rome. He was banished. I mean, now then legends start. Where did Rome, Pilate go? One of the most common legends was he was banished to the farthest reaches of Gaul. And there he lived in a cave as a madman. And he spent 24 hours a day at a stream washing his hands, trying to symbolically, quote, get the blood of Jesus, end quote, off of his hands. Pilate just kind of disappears. And he knew he was in trouble, but he confronted this man. And so Pilate, he was a thug, he was a mobster, he was this, he was that. But history tells us when he confronts this guy by the name of Jesus of Nazareth, now he's stuck.
And so you're kind of making my point about, there are, of course, several different ways to interpret who this person was. But I want to hit one point before I get off here. Isn't it interesting how movies like Kill Bill, you can see 200 people just butchered? Or Saving Private Ryan, and you can see body parts flying here and flying
or
there.
Or Natural Born Killers, which is a real thriller, wasn't it?
Same thing. But here you have the death of one person. It's like one of the most moving movie clips, and it was less than 2 minutes long I've ever seen, is a Russian soldier get beheaded by a Chechen. It forever left a mark on me.
Mm-hmm.
Isn't it interesting how we as a society can put up with the butcher of hundreds and, if not millions, like the starvation of Ukraine, yet when it comes time to viewing the killing of a single person, how much more dramatic it affects us.
Yeah, but Andy, think of this. It not just is the killing of a single person. I think the whole firestorm is who that person is. I think that's the firestorm. I think that's why you can have the bloody... I mean, just before I came in here tonight, I was watching a little bit on CNN, and they were talking about censorship and when it began and is it over and blah, 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 and all the rest. They showed the clip from Bonnie and Clyde. I don't know whether you ever saw it when Bonnie and Clyde, they had, what's his name, Shirley MacLaine's brother, Warren Beatty. And Faye Dunaway. Did you happen to see that movie?
Yes.
Okay, I never saw the movie.
The final shootout?
Yeah.
Yeah.
That is, I mean, that thing is grotesque, yeah. And yet everybody hailed it as an honest cinematic work of art, and yet when it comes to the film The Passion, they're saying it's bloody, it's gory, it's this, it's that, and I'm saying, wait a minute, it has nothing to do with blood and gore. It has everything to do with the fact of the person who's getting whipped, who's getting, you know, beaten, who's getting nailed to the cross. You know what I think it is, Andy? I think it is the average person out there in positions of power, they do not want to have to confront who is this person. I honestly think that's what it is. If this is the Son of God, as he claimed, do I want to confront the fact that we as humanity nailed him to the cross? I don't want to confront that, so I'm going to talk about how... I mean, this is so hypocritical, it's unbelievable.
Yeah.
Hey, Andy, thanks.
You're welcome.
All right, bye-bye. Okay, folks, Hot Potato Radio here on Hot Talk 1080 KOTK. Bob Cryder flying with you solo tonight. The web, the website is not getting up and running. We haven't quite got it here. Josh is in the studio with me. He usually has a studio where he does all this. So we'll try to get something on the website tomorrow if you want to punch that in. If you want to get on board, 503-250-1080, 1-800-727-5955. All right, now, talking about Mel Gibson's passion, Andy calls. I give him as much time as I can. I'll give that to you for the next half hour. Email. You can get to me at email, bob@hotpotatoradio.com. We'll be right back.
Only one radio station has the worldwide resources of CNN at your disposal 24 hours a day. Hot Talk 1080 KOTK.
CNN Radio News Update. I'm Cheryl Castro. At least 100 U.S. Marines descend on Haiti's capital at a heavily secured airport. The Bush administration says the Marines will be charged with securing key facilities in Haiti.
The administration is very sensitive to the perception that it may be invading that country. Officials saying that they have been invited, that they are welcomed here, and that this is something that is inevitable.
CNN Radio Suzanne Melvaux reporting. French troops are due to arrive Monday. The United Nations Security Council is considering a draft resolution to authorize a multinational force for Haiti. Panama and Costa Rica both say they're prepared to temporarily take in ousted President Jean-Bertrand Aristide.
Whoa! Nemo!
Finding Nemo picks up an Oscar for Best Animated Feature Film at the 76th Annual Academy Awards. Renee Zellweger wins Best Supporting Actress for Cold Mountain. This is CNN Radio News. Prices at the pump have gone up yet again. John Lawrence reports.
Over the past 2 weeks, the cost of gasoline has increased about 7 cents, according to the Lundberg survey. And publisher Trilby Lundberg predicts prices will go even higher in the month of March.
Not only does our demand rise from here as we leave the cold month, but costs for refiners are seasonally affected, and so they will be spending more as the months get warmer.
The least expensive gas was found in Cheyenne, Wyoming. The most expensive, San Diego. John Lawrence, CNN Radio, Atlanta.
Rescue crews are searching waters off the Virginia coast for 18 crew members of a chemical tanker that exploded and sank Saturday. 6 crew members have been rescued. The bodies of 3 others were found. Police have charged a relative of a missing Mississippi family with drug and gun charges. Authorities expect to file more charges against Ernest Hargan on Monday. I'm Cheryl Castro. This is the CNN Radio Network.
All right, folks, welcome back to Hot Potato Radio here on Hot Talk 1080. You have to excuse me. My voice is a little thin. I've been doing a lot of speaking this weekend, and this is about my 4th shot today. So, excuse me if I'm a little throaty tonight. Tonight we're talking about here on Hot Potato Radio, we're talking about Mel Gibson's Passion. You have heard a lot of talk about it before the film actually got to the screen. Now the film's on the screen, and I'd like to hear from you. Is there a reason why you saw it? And Andy called in, and he said, hey, I don't know whether I like it or I don't like it. I went to see it Tuesday night toward the end of the show. I will tell you what I thought. I'll tell you exactly what I thought. And having seen movies like this over the years, I'll tell you exactly what I thought about it, because I thought it was a film that, number one, did not live up to the hype in terms of the brutality that I thought. I'll be honest with you. It did not live up to the hype of the brutality. And I'll tell you why. Because the stuff that's been so brutally shown on movie theaters around the United States is not, I mean, this thing wasn't even close to what has been born. I mean, we're talking about Hannibal Lecter eating people. We're talking in real life society, Jeffrey Dahmer's. We're talking about Joseph Stalin, you know, killing probably 12 to 25 million Russians, Pol Pot, all of this stuff. The brutalization of Jesus on the film was not near what the hype was supposed to. I was waiting for women to faint. I was waiting for people to have to get up and leave the theater. It wasn't there. The brutalization was not the gore of it. The brutalization was the Roman soldiers wouldn't quit. I'll be honest with you. I'll tell you. I'll let you in on one thing. The one time it seemed to get too long for me was on the road to Golgotha, where they were going to crucify Jesus. It just went on and on and on and on, and I got to a point where I said to myself, "All right, enough of this. Quit. Let's get this thing over with." And then I realized I was thinking as if I'd walked into the theater to be entertained, instead of walking in looking at history. And folks, it's almost as if you said, okay, enough of the towers crashing, enough of the planes flying, enough of the people jumping out of the windows, enough of that. I want to turn my head, and when I look back, put the towers back up, put the people there, pull the planes out of them, and get back to life as normal. You can't do that, because you're talking about real life. And that's what this movie hit me about. Bob, this is not entertainment. You can't look away and then look back and everything's okay. You look away and you look back and the beating still goes on. The brutalization still goes on, because you're dealing with what happened in history, not what makes you feel good or distracts you or gives you a thrill or gives you your horror shot for the day. This is history. There are a few points in there that weren't historic, but the rest of it is history. All right, Roseanne, thanks for hanging on. Welcome to Hot Potato Radio.
Hi, Bob.
How you doing?
Just great.
Good.
You know, when Lent started on Wednesday, I went to a beautiful service at a downtown church.
Cool.
I think I've been very, very hard on the downtown churches, because I was really uplifted. And then the 1 o'clock movie at the Pioneer Place, I had 13 minutes to get there. And I got there 5 minutes early. And I sat down, and I watched this film. And I got up, and I came home, and I've been thinking about it. And because I don't have a TV, I haven't been tainted by it. And because I only listen to very few talk shows, I haven't been brainwashed by other people's comments.
So, Roseanne, what is your take? You saw the film. Tell me what you thought.
Very simply, I thought that when a person believes in the Bible, like Jesus was taught to believe in the Bible as a Jewish boy who was taught by rabbis.
Right.
And you really know in your heart that what is about to happen to you and what you are about to participate in is written in the words of God, that kind of conviction or faith or purpose that has to be fulfilled for you to know that you are adhering to the Word of God gives you the abundant strength to carry on. I mean, when he could not carry that cross hardly carried that cross. Another man from the crowd was sent to help him.
Yeah, Simon of Cyrene.
He was a big, strong man. Simon of Cyrene.
Right.
Jesus carried the cross with him. When he let Simon of Cyrene was able to let go of that cross, he was totally exhausted, spent. Jesus was still on his feet. The strength of that man, the God, Jesus, was enormous. And I think people, a lot of people don't talk about the strength that brought him to his purpose, to the strength to withstand the brutality of the Roman soldiers when Cepheus said, you know, beat him, but don't kill him.
Mm-hmm.
They didn't listen to Cepheus, although I don't know who Cepheus is, so you will explain that to me later. But the strength, people just ignore the strength of this one man, this Jesus.
You know why I think that is, Roseanne? I think there's one telling line in that whole movie. If you notice, the dialogue is not, I won't go there. There's one telling line in that movie, and that is when they manacle Jesus to that stump in the middle of the court where they're looking to beat him within an inch of his life.
Right.
Do you remember he prays a simple prayer? Do you remember what he says?
No.
Okay, this is what he says. My heart is ready, Father. My heart is ready. And I think that's one of the most, that's probably the most telling line in the movie. The reason he had strength was his heart was set on it, and his heart was set on going through with whatever it required in order to reveal God's love to all of humanity. And when they bound him, he simply said, my heart is ready, Father. My heart is ready. And therefore, when your heart is ready, Roseanne, you can take just about anything as long as you don't lose heart.
Now, the evil that lurks and lurks and follows and lurks and looks and says, will you give in now? Have you had enough?
That's right.
Is it my turn? Do I win? That was powerful too.
That's right. Yeah, and you know, Roseanne, here's the thing. We don't understand that, like, for example, when there's a brutal murder in downtown Portland, you know, some street kids murder one of their own under the bridge, like happened a couple of months ago. Do you think evil is not present there, laughing and rubbing its hands with glee? Of course it is.
I feel it all around.
That's right. And the thing is I think what Gibson did, which is so brilliant, is he put a face on evil. And the face on evil, we've got this little guy in his red underwear and horns and a pitchfork, and he's running around and saying, it's the devil, everybody run. But when evil comes, it's attractive.
It's innocent.
That's
it's
right. It comes.
Quiet. It lurks.
That's
it
right.
Lingers.
That's right.
It looks. It waits.
Roseanne, I think you got it all.
Wait, one more thing.
Okay.
The suffering of the mother.
Yeah.
The flashback when the child falls and she runs to Jesus.
Yes.
Holds him. I think that prolonged walk on Calvary was for all the suffering that mothers feel when their children are suffering, when all the children of the world are suffering. I think it was... I don't think it was too long. I think that's what it meant.
Yeah, I think you're right. Roseanne,
okay,
good idea. Thanks for calling.
You're welcome.
All right, bye-bye. We're going to move on. Folks, 503-250-1080, 1-800-727-5955. Jim, welcome to Hot Potato Radio.
Hi, Bob.
Hi.
I have not seen it. I kind of think I'd like to see it. I'm not sure if I'm up to. The brutality is there, and I mean, I don't know if I got the backbone to take it. But is the brutality gratuitous, or I get the impression that Mel Gibson wanted us to know what he went, God the Son went through, and so did you find it gratuitous?
No. Okay, Jim, here's what it... The people who find it or who think it's gratuitous are people who basically don't know history.
Uh-huh.
All right. We live in a very neat, clean, orderly society. Uh-huh. When we put a person to death, if we do that in this society, we do it in the most, quote, humane manner. We run poison into their vein, and they basically go to sleep. It's like putting your dog to sleep.
Right.
All right? Something like that. The electric chair anymore, or hanging, or whatever. We are a very clean and a very sanitary society. Back in those days, when you put a person to death, you just didn't put them to death. You brutalized them to death. For example, the Assyrians mm-hmm. in their capital Nineveh, who became a world power. When they wanted to put a man to death, they literally peeled him alive. They would lay the person down, strap him down, take a very sharp knife, and cut literally little slits all the way down his body. They would put a fish hook, they would cut it across the top, put a fish hook in there, and they would peel that strip of skin off that person. And they would just literally peel that person alive until the pain, the agony, all of the rest finally did the guy in. Our problem is those of us that don't know history, we don't know what they really did to people back then because it was brutalization to death.
Yeah.
And so when I watched it the other night, I thought to myself, this is probably as close as you could get to reality. But there's still stuff that's missing. I mean, you know, Jim, way in the back of your mind, you still know that as they're smacking him around, you know that's just acting.
Can I stay with you?
You bet. In fact, hang right there and we'll hold you on through the break, okay? All right. Thanks, Jim. And Ron, stick right there because you're on right up after Jim. Here's the deal, folks, is we still have this breathing room because we know this isn't real. But what's really real is when I'm watching the Taliban sit a lady in the middle of a soccer stadium who was accused of murdering her husband, even though it was not true, and a Taliban walking up with an AK-47, putting against the back of her head and literally blowing half her head off. That's reality. That's brutal. But here in this film, we still know that it's part of acting. All right, 503-250-1080, 1-800-727-5955. Have you seen The Passion? Have you not seen it? Do you like it? Not like it? You think Gibson's a wacko? Like Andy Rooney said, a nutcase? What do you think? We'll be right back. Stay there. Potato Radio. All right, folks, welcome back to Hot Potato Radio here on Hot Talk 1080. Engineer Bill is getting creative behind the glasses. We're trying to get in and out of this thing and get the music on board. We'll have it up and running next week and so all the rest. All right, let's go back to Jim. Jim, thanks for hanging on through the break. It's all yours, guy.
Oh, yeah. I read the review or something like that in Newsweek a couple of weeks ago, John Meacham, the managing editor, and he said, you know, as far as historicity, Mel Gibson should have used some other sources, too. And the question was Jesus crucified by the Romans, I think he said this, as a seditionist, you know? And isn't there some truth in that?
It's not as a sedition. Well, that's the charge that was brought against him. That's when they got to the point and say, we have no king but Caesar, which is amazing for the Jews to even say that.
Uh-huh.
We have no king but Caesar because to the Jew, we have no king but God. And that's why they resented the Romans, but they knew. See, what you have to understand is by the time we get to this period of history, mm-hmm. the high priesthood is up for sale. That started about 100 years before, and the Romans would literally sell the high priesthood to either the highest bidder or whatever it is. It's just like, how do I say this, Jim? It's like politics today. How do you get to be speakers of the House? You call in all of the chits that are owed to you by all the guys, and so they'll vote for you. You call them all in, and that's how you get to be Speaker of the House. So what happens is by the time the high priesthood comes on the scene, their basic thing is power.
Mm-hmm.
And so when they see that Jesus had literally hundreds and hundreds of people following him, and when he comes riding in Jerusalem, what's called the triumphal entry, and they're calling him the Son of David, which means that he is the rightful ruling king of Israel, mm-hmm. they say we got to make a move here, or this guy's going to take us over the edge. And so the thing they bring against him is that he sets himself up as king, and we have no king but Caesar. And Pilate knew it was hogwash, but he knew that if he did not handle this situation without it getting out of hand, mm-hmm. then Caesar was going to have his head.
Mm.
And so that's what that's why Pilate could do it, because, you know, they said, hey, he is a seditionist. He's saying that he's a king and not Caesar.
Mm-hmm. One last question.
Sure.
How did the Oregonian review it? I tried to find the review and today, and I didn't read
it.
Oh,
man, there's so many. I got three or four pages here.
Was it more or less favorable? Or
let's see. I've got it right here. The living section, and it says, let's see if they give it a grade. They don't give it a grade. They compare it to King of Kings, the Gospel according to, which was 1961. They compare it to the Gospel according to St. Matthew, 64, the greatest story ever told, 65, the Last Temptation of Christ, 88, and the Passion of the Christ. But they always say things like this. This is amazing. Gibson's film is ferocious in its focus and delivery. And I want to say, you don't say that about the other films that you review, but it's interesting. It, you know, made 26 point some odd million dollars the first opening. You know, the Last Temptation of Christ, which they hailed as a critical success, and its entire run only brought in $8 million.
Wow.
Only $8.4 million in its entire run. That's because it was a pathetic mockery of the human, the historical man, Jesus, and so, you know, Hollywood's going to have to get on the board. The Oregonian is trying to walk a fine line because they know they got a bunch of people out there who really are believers in Jesus as the Son of God, but they're trying to do what I would say they're non/anti-religious. There are many ways to God. Let's all get along, Rodney King type of thing. It's a weird thing.
Okay. Thanks, Bob.
Thanks, Jim. Call again. Bye-bye. All right, moving on. Ron, welcome to Hot Potato Radio.
Hi, welcome. I heard this discussion in my car, and I just went into my house, and I see it from a different perspective. My parents are Holocaust survivors.
Uh-huh.
And my mother grew up in France, and she was called Christ Killer as a kid constantly by children her age. And so it's not so much the historical data and the way the movie was done and how true or how brutal it may be. It's that there are Christians that have in the past taken this episode in history and found it as a battle cry or had used this information as an opportunity to get involved in anti-Semitism.
You know, Ron, I agree with you for most part of what you're saying, but I will make a differentiation between this. Ron, just because I was born in a garage doesn't make me a car. Even though I call myself a car, I can say to you I'm a 1948 Studebaker, and you say, time out, wait a minute. I know a little bit about Studebakers, about cars. Cars are made out of metal, they have four rubber tires, they run on a gasoline engine, blah, blah, blah. So you can call yourself a 1948 Studebaker all day long, and I can tell you that the facts don't match up with reality. So people come along, and they may call themselves Christians, but if they turn around and they do things like calling other people Christ killers, they have just verified to you they are not a true follower of Jesus Christ. I don't care what they say.
I agree with you 100%. My concern, though, is that you said it. You said you're totally accurate in what you say. But there are Christians that do that, and they aren't true followers of Christ. And they, to my mind, they aren't Christians, not the Christianity I know growing up with my friends, many friends that are Christian, and, you know, never having an issue with being a Jew. But there seems to be enough of them out there that this type of thing could get them started. And I think that's the fear that a Jew could have, that the Holocaust was, you know, just yesterday. It wasn't too long ago. I lost my grandfather, my grandmother, and my aunt in the war, and my father survived. He made the switch, and he weighed under 100 pounds when he escaped from a camp. So, you know, my family went through a lot of hardship.
Right.
And so it's very real to me. I mean, it happened yesterday.
And, Ron, and I agree with you in the sense that, for example, when I went through Yad Vashem in Jerusalem a couple of years ago, I went in thinking that I pretty much knew World War II and the atrocities because I am a historian by hobby, and I was halfway through Yad Vashem and I found myself sobbing as I saw photos that I hadn't seen. There's one photo in Yad Vashem I will never forget. Yeah. It is a photo of three young Jewish women, probably in their 20s, maybe 30s. Standing huddled together, stark naked on the edge of a death pit, while Nazi soldiers are standing behind them with guns pointed at their head. And I know that these three young women are in the last moments of their life, and they are huddling together, clinging to one another, and I know the bullets are about to be fired, and they're going to that pit. And I stood in front of that picture, and I stood there, and I wept uncontrollably because and I'm not saying this to be gratuitous, I saw man's inhumanity to man in a way that I had never let my eyes had never seen it before.
Right. So it's almost unthinkable.
It's beyond human. It's animalistic. But this is what I think, Ron. Two things. Number one, because there is a very careful eye being kept on anti-Semitism, especially in America. Now I hope France is listening very carefully as we're talking. But as in America, because of anti-Semitism, I honestly don't think you're going to see this. If you do see it, it's because of people who honestly are trying to create a problem between Christians and Jews. For example, last year, Ron, do you know, and I'm not trying to put you on the spot, do you know how much money evangelical Christians sent to the state of Israel?
Quite a bit, I bet.
They sent over $500 million to the state of Israel last year just to say, we're standing with you.
I know, and it blows me away when I see the modern-day American Christian speak to me as I did 20, 30 years ago growing up in New Jersey. It's like a whole different world. And you're exactly right, and I was afraid... I guess personally that this movie could ruin it.
Yeah, and I don't think it will.
What's your take on Mel Gibson's father being a Holocaust denier?
I'm very saddened to hear that. I'm very saddened to hear that. You know, Ron, we had my in-laws. They immigrated. My wife's grandfather immigrated from Germany over here years ago. Mm-hmm. There was a couple that were brought over during the days of the 1930s when they had these big huge movies, and he was brought over here because he was a great sculptor and he could make he could make these buildings, these plaster things that looked incredible. To the day she died, this lady we knew thought Hitler was a hero and thought the Holocaust was a lie. Mm. She honestly thought the Holocaust was a lie. And we would sit and talk with her, and we would say, it's history. And she said, no, they can write history and blah, blah, blah. To the day she died, she thought Hitler was basically trying to bail out Germany, trying to get Germany out from under the depression that it was in, and the rest of the world just decided to hate Hitler, and so they made up all this stuff about him. But I look at her and I say, she is deluded about history. I say that about Mel Gibson's father, and the real issue is not what Mel Gibson's father thinks, but what does Mel Gibson think?
You're right. You're right.
And the bottom line is, the bottom line is, Ron, is Jesus of Nazareth, for those who are followers of his, the first and foremost thing they know about him was the man was a Jew. He was a rabbi.
Right.
It would be one thing if the Jews, the Jewish leaders of that day, if as the history books say, if they had done this to some kind of a Gentile, or they'd done it to a Samaritan, or they'd done it to somebody else, then you say, aha, no. It was in a sense an interfamily feud,
right,
in that
right,
sense.
Right.
And the guys who wrote about it, they were all Jews with the exception of Luke. They were all Jews who wrote about it. And the thing that I get it, you know, for example, when you get to the book of Acts, the Apostle Paul in the New Testament, he is still observing some of the things at the temple. He hurries all the way back across, you know, a lot of the world that day to get back to be in the temple for a certain feast time. He has his head shaved to keep a vow according to Jewish customs. These guys were Jews.
Right, right. And they live that way. It's just amazing. How can this piece of history have been used to cause so much suffering then? How could it ever be converted into that?
How can a person with one color of skin look at a person with another color of skin,
yeah,
who has the same thing type of thinking? When you cut them, they bleed the same color.
Yeah, you're right.
They can say, because of the color of your skin,
yeah,
you're less than me. It is the evil that lurks in the heart of man. Hey, Ron, we're at a break. Thanks, buddy.
Well, thank you very much.
You betcha. Call again.
Yep. Bye-bye.
All right, folks. Hot Potato Radio here on Hot Talk 1080 KOTK. Bob Cryder along with you. 503 250-1080, 1-800-727-5955. Have you seen The Passion? Have you heard about The Passion? Did Gibson go over the edge? Did he not go far enough? Is there not enough of this story so you really understand what's going on? Does there need to be more? Hang right there. We'll be back after the top of the hour news break.
It's 7 o'clock.
CNN Radio News. I'm Rory Suchet. U.S. Marines touch down on Haiti as the U.N. Security Council considers deploying an international peacekeeping force. For the meantime, however, the island remains highly volatile.
Anything can happen. I think that the Haitian civilians still will need protection.
That's Haitian activist Marlene Bastien out of Miami. It was early Sunday. President Jean Bertrand Aristide finally gave in to the rebel demand and left the country. Hollywood's best being honored tonight at the Oscars in Hollywood. Harvey Crumpet wins Best Animated Short Film as Finding Nemo scores Best Animated Feature Film. And much excitement over Lord of the Rings. It's expected to win big tonight. And live on the red carpet is our Jim Roop. Hi, Jim.
How you doing, Rory? So far, Lord of the Rings has won in every category so far in which it's been nominated. Supporting role Oscars are awarded, too, to Tim Robbins for his work in Mr. Gribber. Renee Zellweger takes the gold for Cold Mountain. Zellweger also won Screen Actors Guild Award at the Golden Globe for the film, and she says she hopes that she can at some point remember the moment when her name was announced tonight.
The invitation alone is overwhelming. So, as soon as I remember the moment, I'll let you know.
Live backstage at the Oscars, Jim Roop, CNN Radio, Hollywood.
Thank you, Jim. Enjoy. All four presidential candidates butting heads during a New York debate today. Contender John Edwards saying his camp wants to put the control of the country back into the people's hands.
It does not belong to that crowd of insiders in Washington. Their lobbyists belongs to you. And we're going to restore the power in this democracy back to you, which is where it began and where it belongs.
Super Tuesday is 48 hours away. Amid the debates today, all four Democratic contenders did unite on the issue of the violence on Haiti. This is CNN Radio News.
KOTK! Would you like to know what the future holds? Call the psychic phone line today and talk with a real live psychic. Our psychics are fully licensed and guaranteed to know what the future holds. Just listen.
Hello, psychic phone line, may I help you?
Tell me what the future holds.
Good news.
I'll be rich and successful?
No, I just saved a bunch of money on my car insurance by switching to Geico.
See what you could save. Call 1-800-947-AUTO. Geico. 15 minutes could save you 15% on car insurance.
This is Eric Muller reporting from Chopper 5.
Cut!
News happens fast. Can I afford to let a cold slow me down? Not up here. When I'm achy, with a stuffy nose and a sore throat, I take Advil Cold and Sinus. It's got the power of Advil to handle tough pain, plus a hard-working decongestant. That's why they call it Advil Cold and Sinus.
Quick, over to the highway!
I call it fast relief for a reporter on the fly.
For tough colds, advance to Advil Cold and Sinus. Use as directed.
Iraqi oil production reaches its highest output since the war began last March, current production at over 2.5 million barrels a day. Meantime, in the United States, gas prices have jumped nearly 7 cents in the past fortnight, and the word is they're going to keep on rising.
Costs for refiners are seasonally affected, and so they will be spending more as the months get warmer to supply enough of what we need, and we do need more and more from here on out.
That's Trilby Lundberg of the Lundberg Survey. The White House is looking to organize a possible summit to discuss the use of steroids by athletes. Well, there's no word yet on a potential date. However, spokespeople for the NFL, NBA, and baseball say they will likely attend. One man dies, two people survive in Biscayne Bay when their 20-foot pleasure boat sinks. Miami police are investigating. The vessel sank while anchored. This is news from CNN Radio. 1,000 pounds of explosives seized, as were two members of the Spanish ETA terror group near Madrid. Police say the insurgents, eager for an independent Basque state, were planning an attack in the Spanish capital. CNN Radio's Donna Renee reports. Half a dozen vehicle crash tests reveal some disturbing results.
Inadequate bumpers mean more out-of-pocket expenses for drivers who get into minor accidents, according to Adrian Lund with the Insurance Institute for Highway Safety.
You buy a car with lousy bumpers, you can spend thousands of dollars on unnecessary damage, not to mention the hassle of getting the repair fixed.
Marginal or poor bumper ratings went to the Suzuki Verona, the Chevy Malibu, the Nissan Maxima, the Acura TSX and the Acura TL. Only the Mitsubishi Gallant earned an acceptable rating. Donna Renee, CNN Radio, Atlanta.
I'm Rory Suchet. This is the CNN Radio Network.
Hot Potato Radio. All right, folks, welcome back to the second hour of Hot Potato Radio here on Hot Talk 1080 KOTK. Bob Cryder flying solo. I got some reviews to read to you, some comparisons in the Oregonian, also in the New York Times about Mel Gibson's The Passion of the Christ. If you've seen the film and you like it, call me. If you've seen it, you don't like it, call me. If you've seen it, you don't know what you think, call me. If you haven't seen it, planning to see it, not planning to see it, I want to know what you think, because I think this movie is not so much about what really happened on the screen, but who are we talking about? Stay right there. Let's talk. All right, folks, welcome back to Hot Potato Radio here on Hot Talk 1080 KOTK. Let me tell you right off the bat, as we're trying to get this whole thing going, this is live radio. Make no mistake about it, we're talking live radio. The phone systems are down right now. As soon as they're up, we'll let you know, and you can get on board at 503-250-1080, 1-800-727-5955. So for the next hour, I will do all the impressions I know. I'll do John Wayne, James Cagney, and I'll take requests from Engineer Bill. No, I won't. I've got a lot of stuff to talk to you about. All right. Jim, I think, called in. And when Jim called in, he asked, are there reviews? Let me just show you, folks, if you don't think words have power, if you don't think words carry connotations that make your mind lean one way or the other, let me show you the way things are written in order to get you leaning one way. All right? In the Oregonian, where they dealt with the passion of the cinema, there's the static again, but we'll just pretend like we didn't hear that, Engineer Bill. The passion of the cinema on the D section, the living section, Wednesday, the day the film opened, February 25th. I'm holding it right in my hand. Let me just show you how the critics get you leaning a certain way just by the way they say things, all right? They've compared five movies here. They haven't really compared them. They've just stuck them side by side. King of Kings, which was 1961. The Gospel According to St. Matthew, 1964. The Greatest Story Ever Told, 1965. The Last Temptation of Christ, 1988. And The Passion of the Christ, 2004. Let's just take the last two. The Last Temptation of Christ and The Passion of the Christ. The Last Temptation of Christ was basically a mockery of the life of Jesus. The whole point of it was that Jesus really kept Mary Magdalene around because he wanted sex. So he had sex with Mary Magdalene and blah, 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 and yada, yada, yada. And Jesus was hanging on the cross, and he was thinking about all kinds of things, and all this went through. And everybody said that Martin Scorsese had made the cinematic, great, historical, blah, 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 yada, yada. The film only brought in $8.4 million. Folks, that's a bust. Nobody wanted to see it. But the Oregonian wants to run those two together. So, I mean, not run them together, but they compare them side by side. Now, listen to the language, all right? Now, I'm going to get a little cranked here, because this is the stuff where I want to just lean over and throw up. Listen to the language, all right? Last Temptation of Christ, they have different categories. Jesus and Company, and then they have Body and Blood, Gospel or Not, the tone of the movie, and memorable scenes. Those are the categories they have. Now, listen to this, all right? In the one Body and Blood, in The Last Temptation of Christ, this is what the Oregonian writes. In addition to nudity and sexuality. That's all it says. Folks, let me ask you, you have kids walking around your house? Do you want them to see people walk around naked and having sex? Do you? All right. Then I would say, you know, in addition to graphic nudity, and blatant sexuality, but all the Oregonian says is, in addition to nudity and sexuality, the face of Jesus is spattered with blood as he helps crucify someone. Jesus helps crucify someone else in the last temptation of Christ. Now listen to this. In one scene, he, that is Jesus, pulls his heart from his chest. Do you understand it? In one scene, according to what this says, Jesus reaches inside himself, grabs his still beating heart, and yanks it from his chest. Is that something that is brutal and gory? Absolutely right. But all the Oregonian says, let me read it, in a nice, clean, neat fashion, it says, in addition to nudity and sexuality, the face of Jesus is spattered with blood as he helps crucify someone. In one scene, he pulls his heart from his chest. That's all. Nice, clean, and very analytical. Listen to the next line, or the next column down about the Passion of the Christ. Brutal and graphic scenes of a beating and a scourging and the crucifixion. Do you see the difference? And one is just kind of, ho-hub, there's some nudity and sexuality, and there's a little blood splattered around, and then he pulls his heart from his chest. The next one is brutal and graphic. Do you see where they get you leaning? Okay, let's go on and look at one other one. Now, this is what I get a kick out of. Here it is where we're talking about the gospel or not. This is Last Temptation of Christ. Not based on the Gospels, but on Nikos Kazantzakis. Should have read that before time. Novel about how an adult Jesus might have struggled between the spirit and the flesh. All right, he's in the spirit and the flesh. He might have struggled this way. Controversial because the last temptation involved Mary Magdalene. Very nice and neat, right? No, the last temptation involved sex with Mary Magdalene. But now we're just going to say it nice and neat about this cinematic breakthrough that Martin Scorsese wrote, so it's very simply, it's not based on the gospel, but it's about how an adult Jesus might have struggled between the spirit and the flesh, controversial because the last temptation involved Mary Magdalene. Now, listen to what they say about the Passion of the Christ. Here it is. The biblical gospels, which Gibson interprets without the help of scholars. That is a lie. I'm going to tell you one more time, that is a lie. I have seen an interview with people who brought in who were scholars to help Mel Gibson make sure he got this thing right. Now, let's go back over that. Last Temptation of Christ. It's how an adult Jesus might have struggled between the spirit and the flesh. Controversial because the last temptation involved Mary Magdalene. No, it involved sex with Mary Magdalene by the one who called himself the Son of God. All right? Now, the Passion. The biblical gospels, which Gibson interprets without the help of scholars, and the writings of Anne Catherine Emmerich, a 19th century nun. Anne Catherine Emmerich was one who had anti-Semitic feelings, and he read from Anne Catherine Emmerich, but he did not bring Anne Catherine Emmerich into the film. All right? But notice that Gibson supposedly did this without the help of scholars. Folks, that's a lie. There are people who are scholars that have their degrees that Gibson brought in and said, is this right? Is this right? Am I understanding this right? Is that what I understand? But they get you leaning, right? Okay, now, listen. In the last very one, memorable scene, in the last very line here, the last temptation of Christ, Jesus carrying the horizontal beam of his own cross bumps against the narrow walls of Jerusalem streets. That's it. You got it? Last Temptation of Christ. Jesus carrying the horizontal beam of his own cross bumps against the narrow walls of Jerusalem streets. All right? Now, the Passion of the Christ opens tonight. It says, you make the call. All right? All the way up in there. This is where this entire movie, the media, for the most part, has you leaning against it by what they say. All right? You ready for the review in the New York Times? Josh Paul pulled this off the internet for me. I don't need to read all the stuff about it. And blah, 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 yada, yada, yada. Listen to what A.O. Scott, excuse me for a second. A.O. Scott says as in his review for the New York Times. Now listen to the language, folks. This language is intended to get you leaning against this film. All right? The Passion of the Christ is so relentlessly focused on the savagery of Jesus' final hours that this film seems to arise less from love than from wrath, and to succeed more in assaulting the spirit than uplifting it. Mr. Gibson has constructed an unnerving and painful spectacle that is also, in the end, a depressing one. It is disheartening to see a film made with evident and abundant religious conviction that at the same time is so utterly lacking in grace. Mr. Gibson has departed radically from the tone and spirit of earlier American movies about Jesus, which have tended to be palatable. Is that what you want out of history, folks? I mean, Ron, who just called here, who lost the tragedy of his family, being lost to the Holocaust, do you want us to go back and rewrite history so that the Holocaust becomes palatable? Gee, you know, Hitler was just a guy, he was just a little mixed up, and he was a little bit, you know, maybe he's a little crazy. And so what they did is they put these people in camps, but, you know, we don't really need to talk about what happened to the camps. Ask Ron and his family. Do you want the truth of what happened to your grandparents and all of those innocent Jews who literally were brutalized to death in the Holocaust? Do you want their story to be made palatable? That's what this guy's saying. He says, Mr. Gibson has departed radically from the tone and spirit of early American movies about Jesus, which have tended to be palatable. If extremely long, Sunday school homilies designed to soothe the audience rather than to terrify it or inflame it. He goes on this. His version of the Gospels is harrowingly violent. The final hour of the Passion of Christ essentially consists of a man being beaten, tortured, and killed in graphic and lingering detail. Guess what, Mr. Scott? That's history. That's history. Once he's taken into custody, Jesus, Jim Caviezel, is cuffed and kicked and then much more systematically flogged, first with stiff canes, then with leather whips dipped with sharp stones and glass shards. By the time the crown of thorns is pounded onto his head and the cross loaded onto his shoulders, he is all but unrecognizable, a mass of flayed and bloody flesh, barely able to stand, moaning and howling with pain. Now, when A.O. Scott writes that, don't you want to run right out and buy a ticket and go see the movie? Don't you want to take a date on it? Your kids? No. But you see, they write it in such a way to get you leaning against it because the issue isn't the violence. Oh, they commend violence in other films. The issue is who was the guy they were doing it to? So what's The Passion all about? 503-250-1080, 1-800-727-5955. Hopefully the phone systems come back up. Or you can email me at bob@hotpotatoradio.com, and I'll pull it up and read it on the air. All right, stay right there. There's more to this movie than meets the eye. Be right back. All right, folks, welcome back to Hot Potato Radio. Here I am standing at the door talking with Clyde Lewis and the voice. I mean, I would give almost anything to have Clyde Lewis's voice. I wouldn't say anything, but I'd give at least $5. I mean, Clyde Lewis comes on, he's got that voice that I always dreamed of. I wake up in the middle of the night dreaming of it. The phones are back up. All right, 503-250-1080, 503-250-1080, 1-800-727-5955, 1-800-727-5955. I'll put you on the air. We'll give you as much time as possible. We got about 38 minutes left on the show. Let me read a couple emails came in. One came in from Andy, who said, Mel Gibson's father does not dispute the Holocaust. His dispute is about the number of Jews that were killed in the Holocaust. That's his dispute, according to this email. It says it's not the whole issue of was there a Holocaust or not, but how many Jews actually were killed. And probably the round number is somewhere around 6 million. It might be, you know, 5.5 million. It might go to 6.2, 6.3 million. All I know was one Jew killed in the Holocaust was one Jewish man or woman or child too many. That's what I know. And I want you to know that those who claim to be followers of Jesus have to stand against inhumanity and injustice to man, or you're going to have a real problem with the guy that you call your savior. You got that? If you don't stand up for justice and inhumanity, or against inhumanity to man, you're going to have a real problem with the one that you call your savior. All right, here's another email that came in. It asked a question, who do you think was in the hands of the devil in the movie? You remember when I think they were scourging Jesus and all of a sudden the woman, it's actually a woman who looks kind of a man and a woman together, she walks through the crowd and she's holding this absolutely awful-looking child in her arm. It looks like it's an adult made up, or maybe it's a child. The child was too ugly to be humanity. Was it a representation of the sinners in hell? Here came another. So if you saw the movie, and you saw the person personifying Satan and evil walking through the crowd as Jesus is being beaten, and he's holding this absolutely horrible looking child in his arms, and the child looks back with this awful, horrible grin. Who was that? Who was that? All right, 503-250-1080, 1-800-727-5955, 1-800-727-5955, or you can email me, bob@hotpotatoradio.com. It'll come right to my computer screen and get it. Let's go back to the movie, because this is what all of America is talking about. Folks, I happen to think that this movie is going to have a huge impact on the world. It is going to be polarizing, but I'm going to tell you exactly why I believe it's polarizing. What we have wanted to do in the world is come together and say, you know, we all ought to just get along. The Rodney King thing, why can't we all just get along? I agree with that, but you get along based on truth. You don't get along by spinning history. You don't get along by saying, well, that really didn't happen. That's what the revisionists are trying to do. The Holocaust really didn't happen. It did happen. So who's going to take responsibility for it, and who is going to make sure that it never happens again? That's how you deal with history. Slavery was true. You're not going to whitewash slavery. It was brutal. It was horrible. So what are you going to do about it? How are you going to make sure it never happens again? And you're not going to look back at Jesus and say, well, it really didn't happen. No, it did happen. So how are you going to make sure that man's inhumanity to man does not happen again? Although, by the time we get to the end of the show, I'm going to tell you who's really responsible. I'm going to tell you who really was responsible for the death of Jesus. All right? All right. Bill, tell me again the name.
Sandra.
Thank you. All right. Sandra, sorry. Whoop. Let's try that one. Sandra, are you there? She's gone. Okay, Sandra, please call back. We got the engineers working as hard as they can, trying to get the phones up and running. So, Sandra, call back in. We'll get you right on there. And anybody else who wants to get in on 503-250-1080, 1-800-727-5955. All right, folks, let's start walking through this movie and start talking about why it is so controversial. First of all, you have to understand that it's controversial for Jewish people because the Jew who shows up on the scene by the name of Jesus of Nazareth says two things. One thing, which is against Jewish faith and religion. There, they quote what's called the Shema. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one. When they say that, they mean there is one person. There is one God who is one person, one being. There's only one. All right. When Jesus came along, he said, I not only am God. In fact, there was one time it says they were going to pick up stones to stone him. He said, for which of my good works are you going to stone me? And they said, we're not going to stone you because of your good works. We're going to stone you because you are a man, yet you claim to be God. So Jesus brought up a problem. Number one is he claimed to be God. And secondly, he claimed to be the Son of God. That leads into what Christians believe is in the Trinity. That is, there are three persons to the Godhead, Father, Son, Holy Spirit. They all share one nature, one essence. So literally, my son sitting across the table from me, we belong to the same bloodline. He's my son, all of that, but we are two separate individuals. He has a nature, I have a nature. The Christians come along and say, nah, there's three persons of the Godhead, Father, Son, Holy Spirit. That's when the Jews stand up and say, what you're really trying to say is you're polytheists. You say there are three gods. No, the Christians say there's one God revealed in three persons. They share one nature, one essence, but they're revealed in three different persons, Father, Son, Holy Spirit. So the first problem the Jews have with it is that Jesus comes along and to them, his claims is, number one, that he is the Most High, and secondly, that there are three persons, or there are more than one person in the Godhead. That's the number one problems Jews have with Jesus. And then, when the Messiah is to show up, now in the political scene, when the Messiah is to show up, he's to do several things. First of all, he is to assume the role, the throne of his father, David. That is, he's in the lineage of King David, the great king in the history of Israel. He's to assume the throne of his father, David. Israel will be exalted among the nations, and all of the world will see that Israel's Messiah is the true leader of the world, and all the world will come to Israel and say, it is your Messiah who truly is the Savior of the world. Jesus shows up, Jesus of Nazareth. He says he is the Messiah, but what happens to him? He gets nailed to the cross, and he dies in front of a crowd. The Jews say, that's not what's supposed to happen to the Messiah. That's because there's a difference in interpretation in the Old Testament. For example, when you look at Psalm 22, which is what's called a messianic psalm, which is what Jesus is heard to cry from the cross. My God, why have you forsaken me? That's the first verse of Psalm 22. And so the Christians say that Jesus is trying to say, look, I am the one David, the writer, was talking about in Psalm 22. If you read Psalm 22, you will see that they're talking about me. All right, the Jews have a problem with the man showing up who says, I am the Messiah, and he gets killed, and he does not assume the throne of his father David. Israel does not get exalted among the nation. In fact, Israel becomes, in an old word, the offscouring of the nations. Titus Flavius comes in AD 70, destroys Jerusalem, sows it with salt. The Jews are scattered throughout the world. They tend to become nothing but human dung around the world in the minds and thoughts of people. So people treat them all the way from the pogrom in Russia, all the way to the Holocaust, all the way to the ways they've been treated in many of the Muslim countries, the way they've been treated in America, all of that. Have you ever stopped to ask yourself why that hasn't happened to any other group of people? Have you ever stopped to ask yourself that? I mean, after what happened with Hitler in World War II, how come that hasn't happened to the Germans? How come it has happened to the Jews? And the Jews are saying, wait a minute, Messiah was supposed to come and do a lot of other stuff. This wasn't supposed to happen to us. Except for those of you who are Jewish, I would just tell you, go back and read what Moses, your prophet, wrote about what would happen in Deuteronomy 26, 27, and 28. And I think there's some understanding there that might help. All right? All right, 503-250-1080, 1-800-727-5955, or Bob at hotpotatoradio.com. And the email that came in says, who was the child in the arms of Satan, the evil one, in the movie? Who do you think it was if you saw The Passion? Phone lines are up and running. Those of you that call back in, we'll get you right on as soon as we're done with this break. Mel Gibson's Passion. Is it worth seeing it? Is it a lie? Is it true? Is it history? Is it false? We'll be right back.
One radio station has the worldwide resources of CNN at your disposal 24 hours a day. Hot Talk 1080 KOTK.
CNN Radio News Update. I'm Rory Suchet. The UN Security Council votes unanimously to deploy a peacekeeping force to Haiti. This as U.S. Marines arrive in Port-au-Prince.
Government believes it essential that Haiti have a hopeful future. This is the beginning of a new chapter in the country's history.
U.S. President Bush there. The four Democrats vying for the presidency debate today in New York, all four united on the Bush administration's so-called late reaction to the Haitian crisis. Actor Tim Robbins wins Best Supporting Actor for Mystic River. The Oscar for Best Art Direction goes to Lord of the Rings. Well, three confirmed dead following Saturday's tanker explosion off the North Virginia coast, 18 still missing. Charges against Ernest Lee Hagen to be announced Monday morning. He's in custody for possible ties to the bloody Valentine's Day disappearance of his adopted Mississippi family. This is CNN Radio News. Gas prices are up roughly 7 cents over the past 2 weeks. Trubia Lundberg of the Lundberg Survey has the stats.
The highest is in San Diego, California. Normally Honolulu is highest, but California is suffering a gasoline shortage due to its new gasoline reformulation.
Meantime, good news for the oil market. Coalition sources say Iraq's oil production is up to its highest level since last March. Grocery workers in Southern California, hours away from voting on new contracts. Salary and health benefit adjustments have been made as three grocery chains hope to end the near five-month strike. Well, an airport on Maui evacuated and many flights cancelled today. This after a man drives his SUV into the ticket lobby and sets it on fire. The U.S. Olympic Committee, the NFL, and NBA could soon meet for a summit on athletic steroid use. No date set yet. This is the CNN Radio Network.
Potato Radio.
All right, folks, welcome back to Hot Potato Radio here on Hot Talk 1080 KOTK. My name is Bob Cryder, flying solo. Just got off the phone with Dave Setti, who's driving up from Medford, and Dave called, and he said, hey, it doesn't sound like you, it doesn't sound like me, because my voice is raspy. I've already done a lot of talking today, and my voice is a little weak, but David, be assured it's me, but he already knows that. We talked on the phone. All right, we're going to try this again. Sandra's on line one, right? Sandra, hang on. Here we go. Sandra, you there?
Yeah, I'm here.
Oh, great. Welcome to Hot Potato Radio. Thanks for calling back.
Oh, no problem. Sorry I lost you the first time.
No, it's our fault because our phones are going haywire. All right, what's on your mind, Sandra?
Well, I was just hearing that email that you got about who Satan was carrying in his hands when we walked through the crowd.
Right.
And I have an idea. I believe it's the Antichrist.
Ah.
Because it's believed that the Antichrist, the idea of the Antichrist was born during the crucifixion. So.
Ah, so when you say Antichrist, I mean, there are people listening to the radio going, who's she talking about? Who's the Antichrist, Sandra?
Well, the Antichrist, there's a couple of ideas. It's either a person or an idea that's supposed to come in the end times. And it just represents the enemy of Christ, basically. That's what the word means.
Yeah.
But, yeah, and supposedly it was generated, or it was born from Satan, whether it's the idea or whatever it is, during the crucifixion.
Okay. Sandra, so you saw the movie.
Yes, I did.
What did you think of it?
I thought it was pretty brutal, but I thought it was very important to see at the same time. Like, it was really graphic, and to be honest, I couldn't watch it all. But it was very moving at the same time.
Yeah, you know, because I've studied history. For example, the Romans used what was called the cat of nine tails, and
yeah.
The cat of nine tails is literally there were leather thongs with bits of glass, there were bits of brass, all of that in the end of it, and it literally would literally shred the back. I'll tell you, there's one part that I was not ready for that caught me off guard, and if you remember, they have Jesus chained to that stump, and they're first of all, they cane him on the back, and then they use a cat of nine tails on the back, and then they undo one of the manacles on his left wrist, and he flops over. Remember that?
Yeah, over.
And I thought, okay, it's over, and I found out it wasn't over. Now they were going to start on the front.
Yeah, exactly, and that really caught me off guard, too, and I think the point that it really started to hit home was knowing that it's historical and knowing that it's actually something that happened. So,
yeah, you know, Sandra, what many people don't understand is that crucifixion was so brutal that many of the guys, and the scourging that went ahead of it, many of the guys who were crucified never made it alive to the cross. And when the centurion rides up and he says something like this, I told you to chastise him, not scourge him to death.
Uh-huh.
Many of the people were scourged to death. And then what they did is nailed a dead body to the cross to scare the Jews away from crossing Rome. And what we saw on the movie was not, it was probably... just in, how can I say this? Just in depiction of what the scourging was like was probably two-thirds of the way to reality of what it was really like. Most
wow.
of those guys died right there. They beat them to a bloody pulp. And then they would nail their dead body to the cross to scare everybody from crossing Rome.
Wow.
But yeah,
It's hard to imagine, but I mean, like it says in Isaiah, it says that he was irrecognizable, and so I mean, in that reason, I think it was pretty legitimately true as
yeah.
how much they beat him.
And Sandra, you picked out one of the verses in the Old Testament part of the Bible that I kept saying, has anybody ever read that verse? It said he was beaten beyond the recognition of being a human.
Uh-huh.
And I mean, you know, while he's, you know, in the depiction of the Passion, he's carrying the cross up to Golgotha while Simon of Cyrene comes along, and you look at him and you think, I mean, I can recognize him as a man, but then when they would zip in, I mean, they would zoom in on his face and you'd see his bloodied mouth and his red eye and his right eye was beaten halfway closed and all the rest of that stuff. And I'm thinking to myself, this is about as close as I've ever seen it be depicted when it says he was beaten beyond the recognition of even being a human.
Yeah, definitely.
I asked somebody who was a historian, who was not a religious person, I said, describe to me what a man's back would look like, or any part of his body when he was beaten before he's crucified. And without even hesitating, this is exactly what the historian said to me. His back would look like raw hamburger. That's
wow.
exactly what he told me.
Well, if anything, then the movie doesn't completely portray maybe what it would look like.
No, because, I mean, I'll tell you, if, for example, if we portrayed what it really looked like, you would have the greatest outcry in the world of even depicting brutalization to that extreme. That's why, Sandra, for example, you may see movies about the Holocaust, but you will never see movies, for example, when people were put into the gas chambers and then they were incinerated in the ovens. You will never see movies that show them unloading charred human remains from the other end of the ovens. Why? Because it is too close to the actual brutality of the event. People would literally not be able to stand it. That's what would have happened if they would have shown the reality of crucifixion.
Yeah, well, I mean, I remember when I saw the Cat of Nine Tails, and then when they flipped him over, I mean, I could picture in my mind what that would have done to his face. And in reality, they didn't even show it that bad.
Yeah.
I mean, you could still somewhat see a face, but, I mean, looking at the Cat of Nine Tails, it would have just completely ripped off its
Exactly right. In fact, Jim Caviezel, in an interview, said that, you know, they had a board behind him, so that when they were whipping him, that there was a board that took the blows, so that they could really lay into his back. But there was a board cut out that was up against his back, so they would not hit him. One of the guys playing a Roman soldier missed. Have you heard about this, Sandra?
No, I haven't.
Okay. One of the guys, when he was using the Cat of Nine Tails, missed. One thong, with whatever was on the tip of that thing, one thong hit Jim Caviezel in his back. Just one of them, all right?
Uh-huh.
It left a 14-inch welt, and it hurt. It was so painful, it took Jim Caviezel between 8 to 10 minutes just to get his breath back.
Wow.
And that was one thong hitting him. That's all. Instead of three hitting him, what was called 40 stripes minus one, because they knew 40 stripes would kill a man, so they would only hit him 39 times. That's why in the background of the movie, as they're whipping him, you hear them counting.
Okay, was that 39 on both sides?
Yeah, 39 on the front, 39 on the back. They assumed that if you hit him 40 times, you'd kill the guy.
Wow.
And they didn't want to kill him because they wanted him to die on the cross. That's why when the storm comes, did you notice those guys went with those big wooden things and they smashed them into the legs of the other thieves, but they didn't do it to Jesus? Did you understand what they were doing there?
I believe they were breaking their legs because they would suffocate them.
Exactly.
They'd suffocate themselves.
Yeah, hanging on a cross like that, the only way you could get your breath is to push yourself up on your feet, on the nail through your feet, and you could get air into your lungs and you'd slump again. But if you broke their legs, they could not push up and they would literally lay there and hang there and suffocate to death. That's why they broke their legs. See, it is far more brutal than we Americans are used to, and that's what we respond to. But Sandra, I think the bottom line is, it's not the brutality of the movie. It's just the fact that the people really don't like showing what happened to the person who was on the cross, who came and made statements like this. Here's the thing that makes it so tough for people, and people just need to get a grip. You either like it or you don't like it. This guy said, I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no one will ever get to God the Father unless you come through me. If you don't like it, fine. You don't like it. If you believe it, fine. You believe it. But don't try to give it, you know, don't try to back off and say, this is just a good guy who came to show how you love people and you die on behalf so that all mankind can love one another. That's sheer baloney.
I completely agree.
Yeah, the guy said, you want to get to God? You come through me. No way else. And that's what they don't like, is that this guy, who is probably, not probably, Time Magazine said, was the most influential person in the history of the world, happened to say, look, if you'd like to know God, you got to come through me. They don't like that. So they will try to make sure that you don't see the movie and you don't try to come to grips with it, because if Jesus was the kind, loving man, which he was, which they claim, we're not supposed to do that to them. And so, therefore, let's get you leaning away from this movie. Hey, Sandra, thanks.
Thank you.
All righty. Bye-bye. All right, folks, we're talking about Mel Gibson's Passion. 503-250-1080, 1-800-727-5955, or Bob at hotpotatoradio.com. Let me tell you something. We got 17 minutes to this show until this show is over, And if I get 12 of you that call in the next 12 minutes, I can only give you a minute apiece. If you call now, you can tell me exactly why you liked it, you didn't like it, you're going to see it, you're not going to see it, or whatever. Mel Gibson's Passion is probably the most controversial film in the last century. In the last century. Not only is it controversial in the United States, it's controversial all over the world. You understand that Maya Morgenstern, who played Jesus' mother, Mary, is a Jewess. She is a Jewish lady. All during the film, Mel Gibson kept asking Maya Morgenstern, is there any place in here where I'm not being truthful and I'm being anti-Semitic? And Maya Morgenstern kept saying, no, you're telling the truth. You're not being anti-Semitic. You're being historical. Folks, do you understand that there were Jewish people on the set giving insight to Mel Gibson? But what you cannot do is you cannot rewrite history. You cannot. You cannot say that the people who stood there and called for his crucifixion were someone other than Jews. They were Jewish people calling for the crucifixion of this man because they honestly believed he has blasphemed against what they call God Most High, and blasphemy brought death. There were dozens of people other than Jesus, there were hundreds probably other than Jesus, who were stoned to death because they blasphemed the Most High. But when it came time to Jesus, they did not have the right to put a person to death. So instead of taking him outside the city and stoning him, which was the practice of the Jews of that day, they took him before Pilate and they said, you got to give the order to put him to death. We don't have that right anymore because you guys are the overlords over us. Was Pilate conflicted? Absolutely. Read the history. You may not like it, but read the history, folks. That's all you got to do. 503-250-1080, 1-800-727-5955, Mel Gibson's Passion, the most controversial film of the century. What do you think about it? We'll be right back. All right, folks, we're back. Let's see, we're down to 13 minutes before the end of the show. If you want to get on board, now's the time. 503-250-1080, 1-800-727-5955, 1-800-727-5955. Let me just tell you right off the bat, Mel Gibson has not put on film anything that has not been out there in the history books for 2,000 years. Do you understand this? This is nothing new. This is Scott and Mr. Scott in his review of the New York Times says that all the other films have been palatable. All right, there's a palatable. That means they've cleaned it up and they haven't told you the real truth. So all of a sudden, you get somebody coming along and said, "Let me show you just a little bit of what the truth was really all alike." And you have people saying, no, don't see this movie. It's graphically violent. It's horrific. It's terrible. Don't go see this movie. Folks, I got to tell you, I know that there are some people who turned away and said, I can't watch this and that type of thing. The movie's not put out for entertainment. It's put out for historical truth. And, I've heard this from people who sat in movies and watched body parts fly. I mean, Terminator? I mean, all this stuff flying, body parts flying over here, body parts flying over there, heads rolling over there, legs flying over there. And they come out and they say, oh, man, that was a real graphic movie. And they say, oh, that's so cool. Oh, 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 oh. And then they say, oh, but don't go see this movie because it's really brutal and violent. What they don't want you to see is something that will make you think, who in the world was this person? And why would this person endure this and get nailed to a cross and say things like, Father, forgive them because they do not know what they are doing. Who in the world was this? They don't want you to think that way. It's a conspiracy behind every bush. You got to watch it. No, I'm just kidding. Victor, thanks for calling and welcome to Hot Potato Radio.
Yeah, very good subject.
Thank you.
Well, only God, Jesus Christ, the God-man, could pay for our sins because all the rest of us are busy just adding up sins every day. and
boy, God, you got that right, Victor. Man, I mean, instead of trying to take him away, we're throwing him on the heap.
That's right. Yeah. So there's no way that God could deal with us, because He won't deal with something that's unjust and lying. And natural man is a natural liar and sinner and so forth. So we're deceitful, and God is truth. So we had to have a Savior, or we could not get saved. And
now, wait, right there, Victor. When you say we could not get saved, what do you mean?
Well, God had to have a perfect man.
Yeah, but get saved from what?
Our sins. You see, every time we break God's word, as written in the Bible, he very meticulously tells us what sin is. Just read your Bible, and we have the Ten Commandments and all the rest of it there that tells us what sin is. We've all broken those commandments, and we've all committed sin. And we can't pay for those sins because, an example would be like if you got a speeding ticket and you went before the judge, and you'd say, judge says, we're going to give you a speeding ticket. You were going 60 in a 50-mile-an-hour zone. And you say, yes, but judge, I've gone through that zone about 100 times before, and more times than not, I've only gone 50, sometimes only 40. So you can't give me a ticket now for going 60. Because so many times I've gone even less than 50 and 50, so that should pay for my one time over. And the judge will tell you, no, you just did what you were supposed to do when you were driving 50 through the 50-mile-an-hour zone. We give you a ticket when you break the law. And there's only one way you can pay for that, is a fine or a jail sentence or whatever, or unless the judge lets you off. But that's the position we are in. If we do everything right, we just break even, because that's what is expected of us by God. But all of our sins are marked against us and have to be paid for. And this is what we could not do because, like we were saying, we just keep adding them up. So God had to have a perfect man to pay the price. And that was Jesus Christ, who was... Mary was used to make his body, and God the Father, God was the Father of Jesus Christ. So he was basically the God-man. And he led the perfect life. He didn't have a sinful nature like we have because of our earthly father. And he was the one, he came, God came to pay the price to God for our sins. It shows the justice, the righteousness, and the mercy and love of God in our behalf. And he did just that. He paid for our sins, that justified us. And when we receive him, we receive his justice and his payment for our sins. He is the payment. That payment was not made and then put off in some place that everybody can just say, well, the payment's been made for me, and I'll just grab it and take it, and Jesus Christ really has nothing to do about it. No, you have to have him. The payment is not separate from him. That's why he says you have to be born again or receive Christ, the Holy Spirit, into your being, and become his property, so that he not only forgives your sins and justifies you, but he remakes you into a, well, after you die and get your new body, you don't even have the sinful nature anymore. You're remade into a holy being, acceptable to God, to sit at God's table in heaven. A very different being than what we are now.
So it doesn't sound to me, Victor, like we have a wrathful, vengeful, divine God up there who's waiting for you just to cross the line, and he's going to smack you dead. But you got a God up there, it sounds like, if this movie portrays anything, there's a God up there who's saying, I love you so much that I will do anything that I can do to make sure you do not destroy yourself forever away from me. And that's what this movie's all about. Am I right?
Yes, but we do have the choice yet to, if we reject Christ and what everything he's done, he is just, and we will come before the judgment seat, and you will come in your sins just like you are. And then he will give you justice, which he already tells you what you'll have to do with you. He'll have to put you under chastisement or under his penalty, which he calls hell, for eternity.
And people look at that, and then I've got to jump off here, Victor. I got one more call to take. But people look at that and they say, well, that's not very kind. Yeah, well, when a guy murders somebody, when a guy breaks the law here, what do? We bring him up before the judge. The jury decides the man is guilty. Do we let him walk? No. The man suffers punishment, whether it's prison for the rest of his life or whether he's executed. The very thing we do to people who break the law, we turn around then and get mad at God for doing to us when we break the law. That doesn't make sense.
Yeah, and we deliver our responsibility our responsibility to our fellow man when we give him the gospel, basically what we were just talking about. Then the burden goes on to that man. If we know the truth, he says, and then you don't, he says, their blood's on your head. That's why you have the missionaries going out, and that's why you have the preachers, that's why you have the Christians giving the message, so that we deliver our own souls from the responsibility that we have to our fellow man.
Okay, Victor, thanks.
Yeah, thank you.
All righty, call again. Bye-bye. All right, let's see if we can squeeze Julie in here. Julie, thanks for calling. Welcome to Hot Potato Radio.
Well, thank you.
You're welcome.
Okay, we came out of the film, my husband and I. When I first came out, I was really down. It was just so horrible to watch the Lord suffering like that. But a few days after, you know, I've given it a lot of thought. It was very powerful, but there were several scenes that have just that keep coming back through my mind.
Such as what, Julie? Tell me which ones.
Okay, one is where they have the Lord on the cross, and they turn it upside down, treating him like just a piece of meat. And then they turn the cross back up, and you know, and it's thumping, and our Lord's on the cross, and how brutal they were without any regard to a human being. It was just awful.
That's right.
And another scene that really struck me was when the raven was on top of the cross.
Oh.
And yes, and the man was blaspheming the Lord. And it's the same today.
The man was what?
Blaspheming the Lord.
Blaspheming. Okay, he was cursing Jesus.
Yes,
right.
On the cross, and the raven took his eyes out. And I'm thinking there are people today, it might not be a physical taking out of their eyes, but they still have gone blind. From the blasphemy and not accepting the Lord. It's the same concept.
Julie, let me ask you a question. Why, I take it that you are one who believes that Jesus is the Son of God, the Savior of the world.
Totally, yes.
Okay. Why in the world would God allow Jesus to endure all of that? Why?
Why?
Why would he allow Jesus to endure all that?
Well, that was the other scene that I was going to tell you that was probably one of the most powerful ones for me, was when the tear came from heaven and fell on the ground.
Yeah.
And I realized that God, and this has been hard for me to understand, that God has feelings. He is love. God is love. And God was mourning that his son had died for us, but he was mourning that we all... He was there for us. The Lord died for us. But to see the tear come from heaven.
Yeah, yeah.
That
was
so powerful.
Uh-huh. Mm-hmm.
And why do I feel the Lord had to go through that?
Or why? I'm just asking why God allowed it, and you already answered the question. I believe God allowed all of that brutality because God says, I want you to understand how far I will permit you to go to show you how much I love you. See, this is the thing that blows me away. This is what you look around at all the great religions of the world, okay, all the major religions of the world. You got a God, you got a demanding God up there who says, you either toe the line or you're dead meat. You keep this rule and this rule and this rule and this rule and this rule. And then you get along this story, Mel Gibson's Passion story about Christ, and all of a sudden, you're in a whole different ballpark playing another game.
Mm-hmm.
And that is if we believe that what the book, the Bible says about Jesus, all of a sudden, you've got God himself showing up in the flesh and saying, okay, you can brutalize me to the point of putting me to death, and I will still love you. In fact, you know, he's hanging on the cross, and what comes out of his mouth? Instead of cursing and yelling, you know, he could have looked those Roman soldiers in the eye and say, I know all about you, dude, and I want you to know you're not going to stand a snowball's chance in hell by the time I get done with you. Because I know
it.
And yet he looked and he said, Father, forgive them.
Yeah.
I mean, that's the most powerful thing. That's why I think, Julie, that all of the most of the media, not all, don't want to get a, most of the media is trying to lean people away from this film because it is much too powerful when you confront the truth face to face.
Well, my husband and I are just driving back tonight. I'm calling on my cell phone. We're driving back. We were in Ashland to see a friend for the weekend.
Okay.
And we were at Starbucks, and people were coming in last night after having seen the movie. And they were all talking about how powerful it is. Now, this is in a very liberal mecca of liberalism.
That's right. Julie, there's the music. We're done.
Okay,
thanks for calling.
God bless you.
All righty. Bye-bye. All right, folks. Bob Cryder here on Hot Potato Radio. You know, I want to offer a dare to you. You may have read the media reviews and all the rest. I want to offer you a dare. Go see the film, all right? You may not like it. You might get up in the middle of it and walk out. It'll only cost you 3 lattes at Starbucks, and you can get in to see the film. I dare you to go see the film, and then call me and tell me what you think. All right, have a great week. And remember, somebody up there really does love you. All right, have a great week. See you next week. Bye-bye.